I'm David Kaposi. I'm the leader of the Psychology of Health and Wellbeing strand of the Open Psychology Research Center. And I'm interviewing today Professor Peter Fonagy. He's a professor of contemporary psychoanalysis and developmental science at UCL, the center executive of the NFRAD Center, and also a training and supervising analyst at the British Psychoanalytical Society. And Peter Fonagy, first of all, I would like to thank you for agreeing to this interview.
I'm delighted to be here.
That's even better. And so it is this concept or notion of openness which I'd like to talk to you about, because the center is called Open Psychology Research Center. And also because, well, I thought of you for some reason. That you are a good person to talk about openness. And when I was thinking about why I think that, I think it's partly because you are a psychoanalyst, but also a psychologist, clinical psychologist. You are very deeply embedded in practice, in clinical work, but also you are famous for empirical studies. And I was wondering about these two positions, which don't very often go together. And I was wondering what you think about this, being in this position of openness. How does it feel, and what challenges does it bring?
I mean, I feel it's a very good question, first of all, David. It's a really good question. It's almost kind of what's the meaning of your life, Fonagy, kind of question. It's really because trying to remain open under pressure from both sides, both empiricists and clinicians, is really quite hard, because clinicians necessarily, and I understand that, they have a very simple interest, which is hard to make sure that their patients benefit as much as possible from what they have to offer. And for that, you need to restrict, you need to restrain, you need to limit the noise that's around you. For a scientist, the only way they can prosper is by opening themselves up the widest possible way to the noise, but then very quickly narrow themselves massively in order to answer a very limited question. Now, if a clinician narrows themselves that much, they're useless. If they are open to everything, if a clinician is open to everything, and they don't have a particular theoretical framework, a particular set of priorities, a particular point of view about their client, if they are not motivated by a set of hypotheses that are pretty much focused on the individual, they're useless to that person. So the logic of the two are quite different. And the points at which you got to narrow yourself are quite different. In both, you can't be ultimately open, but in both, you got to narrow yourself in specific ways. And the way you narrow yourself is really quite different. So when I'm working as a clinician, I'm aware of all kinds of knowledge and information that I have that actually are incompatible with what I'm doing as a clinician. And to be honest, I should really not do what I'm doing, because I'm not doing it in the way that science tells me I should. If I'm doing science, I know that what I'm doing doesn't represent really life as it is, because I know that people are more complicated than I'm allowing in testing. So I think that your question is brilliant. It involves openness in both contexts, and being able to open oneself up as a clinician to hearing voices from your patient that you actually might ignore, but actually being focused on that person. and not listening to the world outside. And as a scientist, you need to open to what other scientists are doing and where the field is progressing. But then you got to narrow it to in a drastic way and ignore much of the rest of the world. So anyway, it's a long answer to a brilliant question. I want to be open.
Yeah. But you mentioned two incompatible positions, and yet you are trying to bring them closer.
But I'm not trying to deny the incompatibility. If I was trying to say, oh, it's falling off a log, it's really easy to do, then I would be denying the meaning of my life. You know, it is something that I've tried to do, that I consistently fail at, that I wish I was much better at doing, and it's probably not doing justice to either adequately. So it's I think it's kind of important for someone to do it, but I wouldn't want to say that if everybody did it, the world would be a better place.
You've been a long-standing advocate of empirical research in psychoanalysis. Would you like to say a bit more about that and where you see the benefits might lie for empirical research on psychoanalysis?
Well, I mean, you know, that goes back to Freud. Freud saw psychoanalysis as integration of systematic inquiry, which is really, to me, what science is, with clinical work. And I feel that I'm deeply Freudian in that way. Not many colleagues agree, but I am fully satisfied that psychoanalysis benefits from input from other sciences, from psychology, from neuroscience, but equally from anthropology, from sociology, from the humanities, that it is a discipline that is probably the most sophisticated discipline in terms of its vision of a human being, and it's immensely complex in that way. At the same time, I think it should be informed by systematic study of itself, as well as systematic study around it that is kind of bearing on its activities.
And kind of turning back the question, what do you think this kind of wider, you know, society or other disciplines, what does psychoanalysis have to offer? Because obviously there's a lot to offer to patients if it's done well, but what is there to be offered in a wider sense?
I mean, in my own mind, there is no doubt that understanding an individual at the depth that you do as a clinician, when you spend in intensive psychotherapy 3, 4, even 5 days a week for 50 minutes talking to them, you understand about the functioning of the mind at a level that you do not easily have access to in any other context. And I think psychoanalysis has shown its value because it generated many of the concepts that actually other clinical sciences, but also other empirical sciences now use. Cognitive behavior therapy was invented by a psychoanalyst. Why? Because they were aware of how people's thinking could control their feelings. why did they have to develop a new discipline of cognitive behavior therapy? Why couldn't there be a sub-discipline within psychoanalysis, or a particular approach within psychoanalysis that is to do with the epistemology of psychoanalysis? So psychoanalysis rejects things that it feels are incompatible with it. Why? Because of goes back to what I was talking about in the beginning, because it goes back to the clinician's need to kind of hold their mind closed, as it were. So Jung gets pushed out, Reich gets pushed out, Beck gets pushed out of psychoanalysis, because psychoanalysis is not very good at absorbing ideas that are different from the very specific set of notions that you need to use as a clinician in intensive psychotherapy with another human being.
Mm. Well, when you were saying CBT was invented by a psychoanalyst, it occurred to me one day it may be said that mentalisation-based therapy was invented by a psychoanalyst. And I actually wanted to ask you about that, because of course the concept of mentalisation is, well, perhaps what you are most famous for. In certain circles, definitely what you are most famous for. And so reading about mentalisation, it's very clearly embedded in psychoanalytic thought and in your own clinical practice, as well as clinical practice of your colleagues. But it has been taken up in wider circles, which perhaps hasn't necessarily happened to most of the psychoanalytic concepts. So I was wondering what you think about this kind of opening up of this concept. So something which clearly comes from psychoanalysis, both in terms of theory and experience, then is taken up by all sorts of other people, interests, and so on, who are not that bothered by psychoanalysis. So I was wondering what you think about that.
What do I think about it? I welcome it. You know, the concept of defense also comes from psychoanalysis, but it's not just, it's restricted to psychoanalysis, either in terms of its use as a concept or its use as a way of protecting oneself from the stresses and strains of modern living. So, you know, defense is, mentalizing is not, it may have been invented by a psychoanalyst, not really, I think, but although probably French psychoanalysis should be credited for originating the term, at least. Maybe they meant something slightly different about it. But I would never want to claim that I have invented something that is actually a very fundamental human capacity. We have Anthony Bateman and I have drawn attention to it and said it's pretty useful if you are working with people to get them thinking about how they think about other people's thoughts and feelings and how they think about their own thoughts and feelings. That is maybe a basic concept of psychoanalysis, but it's also a pretty basic concept of human beings. And it is probably, probably the oldest concept. And to be honest, I think people probably, even before psychoanalysis was invented, people found talking about their thoughts and feelings useful. Even before Freud. Freud made a major contribution because he made it into something that was commercialized, that you could practice as a profession and charge people for it. But probably people discussed their thoughts and feelings with others before and used the process of mirroring and reflecting, which is, you know, just a fundamental aspect of our nature as human being that you can trace back probably about 100,000 years to where we have departed from other primates. So, you know, I think two things. One, nothing should really belong to a particular tradition. It should be owned and it should be open as your forum and your entire initiative, I think, exemplifies. We should open up, and we should make things accessible as part of that. So I'm proud that we have designed a psychoanalytic approach that you can train people relatively briefly, and you can treat people relatively briefly, and it actually seems to be effective. So all those are good things as far as I'm concerned. Democratization of psychotherapy is a good thing.
I mean, when I read about mentalization, and in fact, in some of the videos, you say, oh, it's a silly word for something quite simple. And you don't write this down that it's a silly word, but it's kind of, you know, when I read about it, and it's, as you say, it has a very, it has an intuitive nature, yes, to make sense of other people in terms of mental states. But I also found that the more I read about it, and the more when I hear you talking about it, I'm somehow, after a while, I start somehow losing my bearings. And I wonder why it was, and I wonder whether this is because, as you yourself said actually just now, that at the bottom of this simple concept is actually something quite deep, because it means to kind of the capacity to treat each other as human beings, you know, not as objects or kind of even animals, but human beings. And that however much we kind of wish that we be treated that way and that we are understood, we can't take it for granted. You know, it can break down. And so I was wondering that, you know, at the basis of this simple and quite readily understandable concept is actually something, well, very deep.
You know, your questions are really good, David. I appreciate it. And there is, I totally agree with you. There is something quite deep, and it's quite, and that contains the essence of humanity. And my own understanding of that is less from psychoanalysis, although in part it's also from psychoanalysis, and more from developmentalists like Michael Tomasello and others, that there is something about being with another person, you and I being here together at the moment, and trying to think about the same thing. Kind of, there is something, you know, that is kind of reflective about what I might think about what you are thinking, and, you know, and maybe what might be thinking about what you are thinking about me, you know. It's kind of second order mentalizing, but there is beyond that something about us being together, like co-mentalizing, like doing this interview together, having the intention, the shared joint intention, that somebody who's listening to this should make something of it, doing something together, where we are kind of in a, what we call in a we mode, mentalizing together in the interest of a shared objective. And that to me is something really quite deep. And that to me is also something that I got, if I'm honest about it, I got from psychoanalysis. That those moments when you are with a patient and you know that you are together, you're understanding each other in a quite a special way. You are in the same mental space. And that is a deeply mysterious in some ways, but also enormously valuable part of what I learned in psychoanalysis and what I'm trying to spell out in this other world of science. And I know it's much, much more difficult in that world to spell it out. But as a subjective experience, David, I know I can tell you when I have it and when I don't have it. And when you ask me that question about there's something much more difficult about it than what you're saying, I knew, you know, we were in the same space. That was, we were in a we mode. You understood me and I understood what you were saying, and we were, you know, trying to spell something out that was shared, trying to do it together. Anyway, I wish I could do that in the objective world out there.
Can you say a bit about epistemic trust in this context? That's kind of a more recent concept that you've kind of started to use.
Yeah, but it's not unrelated, David. It's not unrelated. It's quite simple, really, that the idea is that we are in some ways as human beings very dependent on each other for passing on information between generations. So we are the only species on the planet that actually passes on information in a way other than via our DNA. We have something that we call culture, and we pass that on, which is basically beliefs and knowledge and understanding from one generation to another. But for this, we depend on others around us. And that brings with it a risk. And the risk is that the others around us who do not have our best interest at heart necessarily need to win our trust, need to become trustworthy. How do they do that? How can we know who we can trust and who we don't trust? In turn, if we got to learn everything that we know from them and everything that's important for us to pass on to the next generation. And there is this business of shared understanding or joint intentionality. Or, you know, being in the same space where we are, even for a brief period of time, experiencing one another as it were, engaged on a joint journey or working to the same objective. And if I feel that, and I feel that you've understood really what I meant by mentalizing, and because you understood that what I try and hide sometimes, which is for me is if you like, a subdominant text that actually it is quite complicated. You've understood that I suddenly feel, this guy understands me. He can represent how I think about myself. And I suddenly think in the same space that I suddenly feel that actually I'm trusting of you. You're not just interviewing me anymore. I can relax. I can open up. I can share things with you that I might not have shared. But I can, much more important, I can learn from you. I can believe the things that you tell me. And that's really what we mean by epistemic trust.
Can I also ask about epistemic trust? How you understand its role in therapies? Because it sounds to me when I read about it that you don't think that it's kind of underlying basically all sorts, all kind of reasonably well working therapies.
Well, you know, it's underlying much more than therapies. It's underlying a child's capacity to learn from a teacher. A teacher who understands them, is someone they can learn from. I can just give you an example from my childhood. I had a teacher who gave all of us in class at the end of each semester a book, but she chose the book individually for each of us. And we felt that she was really special, and I still remember many of the things that she taught me. She actually taught me Hungarian literature, and the bits that she taught me, I still remember. This is despite the fact that I spent, I kid you not, at least a year on my analyst's couch trying to figure out why I got the book that I got. It wasn't obvious, but I felt very special about that. I felt that she had an interest, and that opened my mind. And that, I think, happens in a good therapy as well, that if a patient feels that their dominant personal narrative is appreciated, then they become open to learning what the therapist has to teach them in terms of how they can organize their life better, how they can think about other people in a different way, how they can think about themselves in a different way. That I have spent many, many hours talking to people who understood me intellectually perfectly well, but it made absolutely no difference because they behaved exactly the same way month after month of me talking to them. So they would talk about their trauma, how it has affected them, how it's affected their way they were treating other people, how they now understood it in the past, how they were trying to work on it, and all that was there, but it made apparently no difference to how they were as people. And it took me a while to realize that actually that didn't really take. It wasn't internalized. It was, they were in a way hearing me, but they weren't listening. That is the difficulty that many people that I treat have, is this lack of trust, that because they have been betrayed, because they have been misled, because they have been treated either neglectfully or unreliably or without individual attention sensitively, they go through life finding it difficult to believe other people sufficiently to learn about themselves from others. And that's not just something that we do in therapy, that's we do that throughout our life. And that's why I think that what therapy does, one of the things that therapy achieves for us, is to open up our minds to learning from the social context that we are in. Not just learning in therapy, but learning from therapy that we can learn outside of therapy.
So this position, it sounds, it's something, this epistemic trust, this is very kind of radically open, and it's something, it sounds quite fragile and it can be abused. But if we have it and it's not abused, it can be very powerful, and I take it transformative.
I would say so, and that, you know, one of the saddest experiences that I've had clinically, and I'm sure that a number of colleagues share this, when I achieve, in one case, achieved very substantial progress with a young person who came from a very troubled background, they, I felt, began to trust me, and they changed, they were beginning to change. And I discharged them, perhaps prematurely, but I discharge them to foster care environment where actually the foster carers betrayed their trust in the same way as their family of origin has betrayed their trust. And I feel now, reflecting on it, that actually what I did for them was unhelpful rather than helpful, because I made them more trusting in this new environment, whereas actually they were far better off to be vigilant and suspicious as they had been. And so we have to be careful that we keep an eye, as clinicians, keep an eye on the environment into which we discharge our patients that may not be as benign as we ideally hope that they should be.
Well, thank you very much for this. It's actually one question now that I'm itching to know. What was the book? Is that how to say, knowable?
What's the book? Ah, well, I don't know. That would be telling. But the book was about military history, and I had wondered about whether it was because she recognized that I had this violent, somewhat aggressive trait in me that she spotted, but I didn't. I figured it out on the couch. She probably gave the books out randomly, but she gave out as many books as there were kids in the class, and we all took it as very special for us. But my God, as a little cue to make us feel special, what we call kind of ostensive cues, it was very, very powerful.
Well, thank you very much for this, and
thank you, David. It's been a real, real pleasure. Yeah. Thank you very much.